Father, we just thank you for this morning. We thank you that our joy is found in you, Lord God. We thank you that the joy of the Lord is our strength, Father, and we find that true joy in you, Jesus. Lord, we just thank you. We're two or three gathered in your name. You're here in our midst. So we just thank you that you're here, Lord, right now, in our midst, right with us, holding us, carrying us, leading us. Father, we just give glory to you. We thank you that you never leave us nor forsake us. We thank you that your goodness knows no end, knows no bound, Father. So Lord, we just thank you for today that we can come and worship you, give praise and honor to you in song, in dance, in our conversations, over food, over coffee, whatever it is, Lord. We thank you that you are here within our midst. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen, church. Amen, Salt. Welcome to Salt. Another glorious day in the house of God. It's great that you've been able to make it here this morning. We have a few announcements. There's always plenty happening. But this week we have... this morning, Brendan and Alex, they delivered over 600 kilos of nuts to the Sydney markets, which was amazing. So, that was at 5 o'clock this morning. So we've currently sold over a ton of nuts. So well done to everyone who's putting their hand to the plow with that. When I talk about nuts, if you're not aware, Salt has a nut farm out on Braywood Road, out at Sassafras. And at the moment, it's harvest time. We have some volunteers who go out regularly. If you'd like to be part of that, please see Meg or Brendan and put your name down so we can schedule in there to help as part of harvest, because a lot of nuts are falling and selling, which is awesome. We currently have school holidays, so if you have little ones, please oversee them today in the Lego department, in the drawing department, it looks like, and that will be returning, not next week, but the week after. So thanks parents for that. Sassafras Nut, open to the public, going back to the nut thing, So for every Friday and Saturday, the nut farm is open to the public. So people can come in and buy their nuts. And Anzac Day is coming up on the 25th. So from 11 a.m., which is on Anzac Day, the nut farm will be open too for that day. And volunteers are still encouraged to come out and help out there. That'll be awesome. Megan Pete will be away until Thursday. So God bless them. They work tirelessly and effort, and we want to bless them as they have a few days off as they go away. Pete doesn't.
Just a quick announcement, guys. I know you've become very used to these beautiful red chairs, but today is the last day of them. And so we're getting rid of them today. So if you can just hang around afterwards, and we're placing all these red chairs just out next to the coffee van. You'll see the pile of red chairs out there. They're going to the tip. And but if you feel like these chairs are precious, please feel free to take as many of them home as you like. And we've got new chairs arriving tomorrow. So if you can help get those out there, that would be amazing. Thank you.
Thanks, Pete. And we just want to pray for Dari and her niece twins are unwell at the moment. Well, sorry, they were born at 26 weeks and just need some prayer support. Their name are Banks and Wyatt. So let's just pray for those little babies. So Father, we just lift up these two little precious babies to you, Father God. We thank you that they have a plan and purpose, and everything falls into line with you, Jesus. So Lord, whatever's happening there, we just pray that you intervene and give them the strength for these little babies and for their parents, Father God. Lord, we pray that you meet them right where they are. Yeah, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's give up the offering this morning. Thanks, guys, as we give into the work of the Lord. The baskets will be going around. Thanks to everyone who gives into SALT, the many, many facets that happened during the week and throughout the year. Wonderful. And as the baskets are going around, we'll walk up Meg.
Just as you're sitting there, I'd just love you to close your eyes. We're just going to soak. If you don't know what that term means, that means we're just going to close our eyes, connect with God, soak in His presence, commune with Him. So just listen to this song. You can sing along if you know it, or you can just sit in His presence. Thank you, Jesus. I'm also just going to pray for Sally Campbell's mum while we're here. Lord, we just thank you for Sally and Alex and for her mum who, Lord, has been fighting for her life on many fronts. And we just pray covering over her and your healing over her body, and that you would carry Sally and Alex and her mum and her family through this season. In Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I don't know if you know what it actually means, if any of us really know what it means to come to the altar. You know, what does that mean? We all have different pictures of what coming to the altar might mean. But there's a place and an invitation that Jesus has over our lives, which is come and lay your life down. Come and lay your life down for me. You know, and guys, don't welcome to new people. Don't worry too much about the kids. They're all good. We're family here and we all adapt. But coming to the altar is very much a place of surrender. And a few weeks ago, or a couple of weeks ago, I can't remember, I spoke on yielding to the way of Jesus. You know, and then we had a beautiful Easter weekend where Stu got up and shared communion with us and talked about inviting Jesus into his boat. And then Pete spoke about Jesus inviting us into his story. You know, and behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Behold, Jesus, the one who takes away the sin of the world. And here he is in Mark chapter 1 in the Gospels, verse 17, walking along beside the lake and sees a few fishermen, and he looks at them and he says, come, follow me. Jesus said, come, follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people. At once they left their nets and they followed him. So, you know, when you and I recognize that Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and we say, yes, come into my life, forgive me of my sin. I choose to live for you. I want to behold you like the disciples did. I want to live for you. And we essentially, in that place, we're inviting him into our boat, like Stu referred to, saying, come into my life and live with me. But you know what he does? He reciprocates that and he flips it. He says, yes, 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 I will come into your life and into your story, but I invite you into my story, which is a much bigger story than your story. And as you accept an invitation into his story, your story takes on a whole new meaning. A whole new way of life. You know, he says to you and I too, he says, Ash, come follow me. Come follow me. I will make you someone who fishes for people, not fish. I mean, that related to their profession, obviously, and maybe not so much Ash's. But come follow me, because I want you to reach the people in your sphere on this planet and tell them all about me and what I have done for them. So when Jesus comes to us and he says, come follow me and be my disciple, what he was saying to his disciples essentially was, be like me. Come follow me. Come into my story. And for the next 3 years, Jesus showed them his way and they followed him in it. And you know what? When we invite him into our boat, yes, it's personal. It's very, very personal. It's very, very intimate. It's you and him. This is a story about you and him, and you encountering a love like no other. And he is very, very interested in pouring that out and engaging with us on a day-to-day basis on the minute things and the big things that matter to us. But he doesn't want us to stay there. He wants us to encounter his presence because it's in that place we are transformed into his likeness. We get changed when we have an intimate personal relationship with Jesus. But then he says, don't leave it there. I actually invite you into my story. As we're engaging in this beautiful, wonderful fellowship together, you and me, I've got an amazing destiny over your life and a call to reach the people around about you for me. See, we get, I think in our culture particularly, and even like, I mean, I've been in church since I was a kid, but even now, more so than ever, we are so self-focused. Does anyone else kind of agree with that? We are kind of pretty preoccupied with ourselves and God meeting me in my need and for my stuff. And Lord, you know, if I don't feel you or if I don't have a good day, then God, like, are you really real? And we have these faith crises because things go wrong in our personal world. And Jesus is wanting to meet us in such a way that our faith is established in him no matter what our day-to-day looks like, because he has a much bigger plan for our lives. And so rather than staying self-focused and staying in that place, he wants us to live intimately in connection with him, but he wants us to live that out as if we are a disciple of Jesus. What does it mean to be a Christian these days? What does it mean? Does it mean that, I subscribe to a set of beliefs and I rock up to church on a Sunday and I do my best to be a good person? I think we've watered it way, way, way down. Way down. When you read the Gospels, Jesus shows us what it means to be a Christian. When you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, when you sit in those books of the Bible, there you have the evidence of what it means to be a disciple of Christ. Jesus invited his disciples and he invites you and me into a radical countercultural path. And he did it with his disciples as he journeyed to the cross where he took away the sin of the world. For 3 full years, when he said, come, follow me, they lived, they ate, they went everywhere together. And then he went to the cross 3 years later. He modeled to them the life he wanted them to live. And it was after that that the church was birthed. It was after his death and resurrection that they all got together, these radical countercultural disciples that had followed the way for 3 years, now got together in a gathering and it got called church or the ecclesia, where they taught Jesus' teachings and they followed his way and they lived their lives according to the way he taught them to live. And more than 2,000 years later, the invitation is the same. The invitation is exactly the same. He is inviting us into his story. He is wanting a personal connection with each of us. And he says over each of our lives, come, follow me. Come, follow me. You know, and what was this radical way? What was this way of Jesus that he modeled? If you read the Gospels, let me tell you what it was. It might be uncomfortable for some of us who are used to maybe turning up to church and living our lives as good people and thinking that that actually is what a disciple is. It's so much more. There's so much more. That's essentially can simply be watered down to being religion. But Jesus led them in a way where he delivered people from demons. Have you seen any of that lately? He delivered them from demons. He healed their sicknesses. He forgave. He led them in the way of forgiveness. You know, as Christians, we're like, oh, that person was mean to me. I'm going to be mean back to them. It's our humanity. It's our flesh rises up in us. And we're like, yeah, get them, God. No. Pray for them. Pray blessing over them. He led in the way of loving enemies. He led in the way of communing with his Father in prayer. Jesus prayed. If Jesus prayed, why aren't we praying? Why aren't we drawing aside to quiet places to spend time with the Father? Jesus, you modeled to us, he modeled to us love and inclusion. He ate with sinners, and the religious people hated him for it. He did not judge them. He loved them. He forgave them. He led them in a better way. He modeled community and what healthy community looks like. He walked in freedom and he invited the disciples to walk in this. It's like that Lord of the Dance. I mean, what a song. What a song. We need the guitar out next time, Brad, and have a dance party. Can we do that? He upset the apple cart. He upset the religious apple cart by breaking the Sabbath to heal people, by eating when they were hungry. He led the way in freedom. He led the way in saying, it's the merciful and the meek that will inherit the earth. Counter-cultural. It's the merciful and the meek and the poor and the humble that will inherit the earth, that will be blessed. Counter-cultural to my day and age, to our day and age. He led in loving our neighbors as we love ourselves. Where traitors were forgiven. Traitors who led him to his death. A traitor forgiven. Blows my mind. Put yourself in his shoes. This is the way of Jesus. This is the power of one Christ-like life. You, me, plus Tracy, plus Guy, plus B, plus Trevor, plus Jeanette. How many Christ-like lives? The power of one plus one plus one plus one plus one Christ-like life on this planet, radical and countercultural. And powerful in the sense that people are set free. And people get to encounter the amazing power of Jesus and the God of the universe. I always come back to that scripture in Revelations where it says, if you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. I want to be lukewarm. I want to be a little bit on the other edge. And you might think I am sometimes, but I'm okay with that because I feel like lukewarm is not a place any of us want to be. He doesn't say, get it all together and then you'll have everything you need to be a disciple of mine. He doesn't say that. He picked up fishermen on the side of the road. He grabbed a tax collector who was robbing people and he said, come and follow me. The criteria is not your self-righteousness. The criteria is your hunger to follow a Jesus who will radically transform your life and the lives of those around you. And he has called us to live like that. And he wants to light a bit of a fire. Yep, new seats, fantastic. But he wants to light a fire under our bottoms and hopefully not burn the new seats. Sorry, Pete. But because he wants us up, out of our seat, out of our comfort zone. Who loves their comfort zone? Oh, getting in your jammies, making a cup of tea. Not going to say that. But, you know, putting your slippers on. Just, we all love our comfort zones, and there's nothing wrong with that, but sometimes we live our lives to make ourselves comfortable. And he's like, nah, I've called you to be fire starters. I've called you to light fires everywhere you go in this community, in your family. I want you to bring the power and the life of me, myself, Jesus, into your community and radically transform it like the disciples did when they birthed the early church. You know, that's what the disciples did when they birthed the early church. And yes, they got pushback. Don't be surprised with a little bit of pushback, as long as the pushback isn't coming because we're being arrogant or whatever. If the pushback comes because we're passionate about Jesus, then so be it. Then so be it. There's nothing wrong with being passionate about Jesus. I'd much rather be passionate than be lukewarm. You know, he turned the tables on the greedy and those that operated in religious control. He modeled humility and he modeled sacrificial love, where lives are laid down for others. And the disciples went on and lived like him. And he is calling the church in 2023 to wake up, to let the fire of God burn in our hearts. And if you go, I don't even know what that means. Just say, God, make me hungry. Make me hungry to know you. Make me hungry for you. And start spending time in his presence. Because he wants nothing more to light a fire in your heart if you'll let him. And he wants nothing more for you to say yes to jumping into his story, where your life will be more fulfilled than it could ever be outside of his story. I just want to read to you John chapter 15. Many of you may know the scriptures of the vine and the branches. John chapter 15 from verse 1. And this is Jesus speaking. So this is him speaking. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean, forgiven, because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do what? Nothing. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up and thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. So this passage of scripture is about us connecting into Jesus and Jesus' life flowing into us. It's a picture of a branch in a vine, grafted into a vine. Now, you might be an incredibly capable, clever person, and you might think, yeah, I do pretty well on my own. I do pretty well without being grafted in. But these scriptures actually say that without being grafted into the true vine and his life flowing through us, we are not going to produce any fruit that is of consequence eternally. He is inviting us into this beautiful relationship where, as we graft our lives into him and he flows through us, the fruit we produce has eternal value. What do you think that fruit might be? People. People. much fruit others outside of you. A life, the fruit of the Spirit, that is a life that impacts the world around you with the beauty of Jesus. Wow. You know, if we sit in the Gospels for the rest of our lives, if we just sit in Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, we will be forever challenged about what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. And he is inviting us into a relationship with him where we will bear eternal fruit. This is where your best story is. You know, your best story. Yes, you can invite him into your story. Put him, for sure, put him in your boat, as Stu led us in last week. Put him in your boat. But then put your boat in him. Put your boat in him. Because as you put your boat in him, you're grafting yourself into him so that your story, your life, the things that are important to you, the people that are in your world, the future plans for your life are now caught up in the grand destiny of what Jesus has for the planet. How phenomenally amazing is that? This is where our peace sits. This is where our joy resides. This is where our hope is. When I actually choose to invite him in and then live in him for him. This is the invitation he has over our lives. This is the invitation he has over you and me, because separate to this, I will bear no eternal fruit. What we're going to do is we're going to break up into some small groups and really put you out of your comfort zone again. We haven't done this since COVID. So just with the people you are sitting near, can we just break up into groups of like five? Don't make it 8, 10, because you won't hear each other in the acoustics in this room. But just groups of five. And I've given some people questions. So you may have someone come and jump in your group with some questions that we're going to actually discuss together. Okay, but just before you do it, I've got some people already organised. Good on you. You're doing it. I'm just going to pray for us, okay? Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you that you, Jesus, are the vine. You are the one planted in eternal life. And you want to graft us into you, so that we become disciples of you and live as you've called us to live. Lord, today I pray for each of us that we would be bold and brave enough to make a decision that I just don't want to keep doing same old anymore. I want to live my life according to you and what it means to be a disciple of Christ. Lord, would you come? Would you meet us right where we're at? And Lord, would you come and just, dare I say, radicalize us for you, Jesus. Make us passionate lovers of you. And that the rest of our lives will be lived out according to that. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.